سيدتي وسادتي، مرحبا بكم وشكرا كثيرا لوجودكم في المحاضرة هذه. أريد أن أشكر سفارة السعودية، أريد أن أشكر الجامعة كين عبد العزيز لسبب هذه، أريد أن أشكر كمان كاسا عربي ومديرهم، وأريد أن أشكر كمان الأستاذ الذي معي اليوم. Thank you very much for being here today. And we don't have much time, so I'll try to be short in the presentations. This is the final and probably the most important session of the day, since we will be speaking of finance. And finance is simply what it moves the world today. So I think we have the chance of having two good experts in the world of finance and the role of Saudi Arabia. And of course, of his oil policies and reserves policies in balancing out the world finance today. We will have first Dr. Mohamed Saleh Saban. He's an economist. He's trained at the great University of King Abdelaziz. And he also has been trained in California and has a PhD in Boulder, Colorado. He has a very large experience as consultant from the Ministry of Oil and Mineral Resources, and he's been participating in many of the international conferences regarding oil politics of environmental and energetic policies. So I would like to take more time from him. You have 20 minutes. You can take the ISIL, and we're looking forward to him.
Thank you very much, Madam Chairperson. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. في البداية أود أن أشكر جامعة الملك عبد العزيز، جامعتي في الواقع، على توجيه الدعوة لي من خلال كرسي الاعتدال، من خلال كرسي الأمير خالد الفيصل للاعتدال، لأتحدث عن الاعتدال في السياسة السعودية. وأنا أفهمت بأن الورقة لابد أن تكون باللغة الإنجليزية، ولذلك عديتها باللغة الإنجليزية، وأرجو المعذرة إن تكلمت باللغة الإنجليزية بالنسبة للورقة. Talking about the Saudi oil policy and the moderation in this policy is not something of a mystery. Everybody knows. Even when you ask any regular person in the West or in the developing countries, how do you know Saudi Arabia? They will say, well, a big oil country that always have a moderate pricing policy. And I think this has been acknowledged by all countries and been appreciated also. The policy is based upon three factors: maintaining moderate international oil prices to ensure the long-term use of crude oil as a major energy source. Secondly, developing sufficient excess capacity to stabilize oil market and maintain the importance of the kingdom as a crucial source of oil in the long run. And thirdly, utilizing the oil revenue to develop its economy in a more diversified manner. Of course, His Excellency Mr. Muallimi indicated that, well, everybody knows that Saudi Arabia has the largest conventional oil reserve of about 260 billion barrels, and also is the fourth as far as the conventional natural gas, with the total reserve of 284 trillion cubic feet. And lately, we all heard the announcement by Saudi Arabia that there is huge discovery of shale gas in Saudi Arabia. The estimated recoverable reserves of shale gas is around 660 trillion cubic feet. just second to or next to the United States. With the United States, of course, they do have about 880 trillion cubic feet. So that will put Saudi Arabia in line with the new development. And instead of causing some worry because of the abundance of gas and the lower prices, now we see that with the additional gas that we have, we can definitely utilize it domestically in order to release more oil for export. But this is a side point, of course, with regard to our main issue. So it is well known in the international community that Saudi Arabia is dependable, reliable, and secure oil supplier. This goes without any question. Whenever we go to any international meeting, whenever we go to any bilateral meeting in the United States, in Europe, they totally acknowledge that this has been a very positive role being played by Saudi Arabia in the international scene, international oil market. Without the Saudi proper interventions in the market, we could imagine what kind of volatility that could arise with the existence of any supply disruption here and there. And there are several examples, of course, of the Saudi intervention. Market stability is very crucial, not only to Saudi Arabia, but for the whole world and for the world economy. Because we all know with the kind of volatility and high oil prices, and because of the still strong relationship between the unit of oil and unit of the growth of GDP, we cannot separate the impact of higher oil prices from not to affect the GDP growth. So I think this has been very clear, and Saudi Arabia is following the path of having a moderate prices that will be acceptable not only to producers but to consumers and also investors. Because without getting investment to bring new capacity, that would result in some kind of shortages that will not be helpful to the world economy. And therefore, we think, Saudi Arabia think that let us get together and see what kind of oil prices that we will be acceptable to both. High, very high prices, not acceptable to Saudi Arabia. Very low prices are not acceptable to Saudi Arabia and to the international community. So that is why, with the right instrument in the hand of Saudi Arabia, which is the excess capacity, we can use this instrument in order to satisfy the market and in order to fill any kind of disruption that been created due to different reasons. If we go back to the history, before the 70s, we all know that OPEC was established in 1960, established by Saudi Arabia, Iran, Iraq, and Kuwait and Venezuela, five countries. But until 1970, the role of OPEC was basically passive. It was basically to prevent international oil companies from lowering prices, because at that time, this cartel of the Seven Sisters, what been called Seven Sisters, they are seven major oil companies, and they were in kind of monopoly in the world. They tried to reduce production from one country and increase production in another country in order to pressure one country at the expense of other. And they reduce prices because at the end of the day, they own the refineries. So if the price of the crude is very low, they can get the profit at the end use of the refined products. So this is basically the kind of policy that OPEC was doing before the 70s. But in the 70s, when there was some kind of nationalization, let us say, of the oil companies working in the OPEC countries, they didn't call it nationalization, they call it participation agreements at that time, which is because it was gradual, 25%, 50%, 75%, until 100% ownership or gaining back the oil concessions from the major oil companies. By that time, OPEC countries had the full control on the decisions of their production, and also, of course, setting prices. At the early 70s, of course, we don't want to go back to the different incidents, but definitely OPEC, contrary to the economic understanding, OPEC was fixing prices and also fixing production. In basic economics, and we have economists here with us, you can either fix prices or production. But at that time, until early 80s, OPEC was fixing prices and production. And that created some kind of countries adhere or not adhering to the quota and to the prices. And in the early 80s, when structural changes happen in the market, and we have seen demand is going slower than expected because of this conservation, other energy sources came into line. And also at the same time, supplies from non-OPEC countries, including North Sea, et cetera, came on stream. This has put a lot of pressure on prices and put a lot of pressure on OPEC countries to reduce their production and to maintain high prices. At that time, Saudi Arabia was in a very critical position because of the, I'm not going to say cheating, but the total inadherence to the quota, production quota and prices by some OPEC countries. And while Saudi Arabia was fully adhered to the prices, official prices, and also to the quota, some other countries were giving discounts. So at the end of the day, or in 1985, per se, I mean exactly, the Saudi production went to a very low point of 2 million barrels per day. So at that time, we all know the rest of the story. In 1986, Saudi Arabia announced that we cannot continue with this act, and it is a free market for all, and that has brought the prices to the level of below $10 per barrel. But then that showed the other OPEC countries that they need to honor their commitments, and they need to follow. They learned two lessons. One, that they need to honor their commitment. Secondly, that high oil prices definitely will initiate structural changes in the market that will not be beneficial to the OPEC countries. So from 86, 87 until onward, Saudi Arabia was in the driver's seat, as expected, since it is the largest producer with the largest reserve, et cetera, et cetera. And with this kind of moderate pricing policy, that the world respected Saudi Arabia for it, and also member countries within OPEC start to listen to Saudi Arabia because they have learned the lesson in the 70s and in the early 80s. So usually there was a compromise among the OPEC countries, and the compromise tend to be towards the Saudi line of thinking. of moderate prices, moderate interventions, limited intervention in the market, etc. And I think by so doing, Saudi Arabia succeeded in being the leader of OPEC and the leader of the oil producers. Of course, there were some periods of low oil prices, very low oil prices. And OPEC was not able to do it alone. So Saudi Arabia also, again, went to Venezuela, went to the to Norway, Mexico, and Russia. And they were convinced to participate with Saudi Arabia. And whoever wished, it was Venezuela, the other party from OPEC, to, in order to salvage the market, in order to prop up prices to a level that will be reasonable, not high level, but at least not the level that it used to be in the 1997, for example, when it went down to less than $12. So, but in the case of high oil prices, Saudi Arabia mostly done it alone by pumping more oil in order to bring prices down. And we had two major incidents, if we all recall. One is in 1980-81, when the Iraqi-Iran war started, and we have seen the curtailment of the production and the loss of production of some of the production of Iraq and Iran. So prices went very high, and everybody was looking at Saudi Arabia. They are the one with excess capacity. As we said, that this is one of the pillars that Saudi Arabia imposed on itself, even though it is costly to have excess capacity. But they know, as a matter of responsibility, as a country of responsibility, they had to invest to have at least 2 million barrels per day as an excess capacity. So it helped. In that case, in 1981, we increased our production to 10 million barrels per day. And it was not that easy, but we tried very hard and with additional investment until we got to that point, even though we already had, at that time, 2 million barrels per day excess capacity. But the gap was more than 2 million. The gap was more than 2 million barrels per day. The second incident is in 1991, during the Gulf War. Also, we have seen that the Kuwaiti-Iraqi production went out of the market, so Saudi Arabia stepped in and also increased its production. This has been appreciated a lot and acknowledged, because without this intervention, we don't know what kind of markets we could have. And of course, the consequences will be impacting Saudi Arabia also, because we are part of this world. If there is economic slowdown, that means slowdown in the demand for oil, etc., the whole circle. So I think not only these two incidents, but these are only examples. Of course, we all know when the Libyan oil been cut during the Libyan crisis, also Saudi Arabia stepped in. And not only stepped in, but tried to whiten its product. What does that mean? That means that instead of having our exports, mainly medium and heavy crudes, we try to export more of the light crudes in order to match the Libyan crude that has been lost in the market. And that was appreciated by Europe in particular, because they were heavily dependent on the Libyan oil. And now, of course, during the Iran crisis, Saudi Arabia has also stepped in and increased its production to 10 million barrels per day. Let us finish with this part. The other part that has very important, Saudi Arabia has very important role in, is that Saudi Arabia was the one who initiated the dialogue between producers and consumers. And I was there in 1991 in Paris when the first dialogue took place. And it was only, I remember, it was not represented by ministers from the consuming countries. They were against the idea, how could we sit with OPEC countries and discuss, and they want us to discuss prices? No way. We need to leave it to the market. So the United States was represented by the deputy minister and some other countries also, while Saudi Arabia, Venezuela, France also was a minister, because they were hosting the meeting. And gradually we had this biannual meeting where understanding was much better over time. And we have seen that gradually ministers themselves from the West attending these meetings, and not only attending, but participating and discussing all issues, including prices. And then in the year 2000, Saudi Arabia took the initiative, King Abdullah, the custodian of Two Holy Mosques, in the meeting in Riyadh of the forum. By the way, this has been called later on, after 1991, called the International Energy Forum. So King Abdullah bin Abdul Aziz took the initiative and said that Saudi Arabia is willing to host the Secretariat of the International Energy Forum in Riyadh, because this will provide all logistical and institutional needs, requirements of the, and will be regulating this forum. And now the forum meets every 2 years, and they are discussing all issues, all energy sources, prices, taxations, and everybody is very frank, and there is no confrontation. And because of Saudi Arabia and its role in bringing in producers and consumers, we see not total agreement, but there are some issues where we have disagreement with the consumers. But on average, definitely, it was better, much better than confrontation that used to be in the 70s. I'm sorry, I have a lot of other things, but I know that I'm running out of time, and thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Savannah. I think it was really interesting, and for many of us, it really makes us understand many things of the oil politics. Without taking more time, I'd like to introduce you to Dr. Ignacio de la Torre. He's the director of the Masters in Finance at the Ivey Business School. He's also a member of our Saudi Spanish Center for Islamic Economic and Finance. And he has a very long career as a financier and as a banker in many international institutions like Deutsche Bank or UBS or Spanish banks. And he will also give us his vision on the Saudi Arabia financial politics from his point of view of a foreign.
Okay, thank you very much, friends, for coming over, and thank you, Dr. Mohammed. It is widely said that Pope John Paul II played a major role in ending with communism, and if you know about geopolitics, you will see that this was not a real thing. But actually, the fact that Saudi Arabia increased its production since 1985 until 1991, this played a major role in keeping oil prices down and making sure that the Soviet Union would go bankrupt, because the cost of extracting oil in Russia is $20. So I think many people should be grateful to Saudi Arabia because of the end of communism. What I'm going to be talking is about the situation on the macroeconomics of Saudi Arabia, the opportunities that lie within your country on the current account surplus, and the risks which are beneath that. To finish off a little bit with a couple of ideas behind Islamic finance. As you know, the kingdom today has one of the largest current account surpluses in the world. This basically means that if you get $100 out of worth in your country and you're only investing or spending, let's say, 90, and the other 10, you are saving it. Now, saving is good, and it's the main problem with the US, that they don't save, but it could be also a danger. The Chinese have saved a lot of money. They have invested all this money in dollars, and they will be losing plenty of this money. This will be the largest capital loss in world history, the Chinese savings into US dollars, and we'll be talking about this point. Okay. And on the other hand, the other key issue obviously impacting the surplus of Saudi Arabia is the oil. So it's a key challenge for the country to diversify its revenue streams. Otherwise, the risk associated with this surplus is extremely high, as we'll see in a minute. Here you have the different positions of current account as a percentage of GDP. Okay, what you can see is that Saudi Arabia, with levels of 30% of current account surplus, is by far the country in the world with the largest current account surplus. As you see, China is no longer a big player as a current account surplus. It went down, as trade has also been balanced. And this basically tells you that today, Saudi Arabia is the big financier behind the rest of the world's deficits. Okay. Again, this can be a good thing and a bad thing. I will be discussing about these points. Obviously, the big deficit still is that of the U.S., which is more or less $400 billion of deficit. This means that they invest and consume more than what they save. Okay. So this is a paradox. When the U.S. was in the levels of $800 billion in 2006, this was financed by Chinese savings and by savings of countries such as Brazil, which is a paradox that a country which was poor, such as Brazil, was financing the consumption of the rich Americans. Today, the imbalances are much lower, and this is very good. We are in an economic crisis, but the imbalances behind the world are much lower than in those of 2006. Yet, the big deficit is in the US, the big surplus is in Saudi Arabia. Now, why this might be a big problem for Saudi Arabia? This is the yield of the US bond. The lowest the yield means the most expensive the bond. This means that today the US bond is at the most expensive price in its history since the independence of the United States. This means that if the huge surplus accumulated by Saudi Arabia is channeled through US dollars by buying bonds, as you are doing now, you are buying an asset at the most expensive price of its history. And this is a huge risk for the kingdom, as it is for China. Obviously, the problem is that there is not many alternatives, but you should be aware that buying something at extremely high prices is extremely risky. It could be less risky if the nation to which you are financing doesn't have much debt. But if you look at the federal government debt in the US, it's close to reach 110 points, which is the largest or the highest level since the Second World War. And of course, fundamentals sooner or later drive prices. And the fact that the bond price in the US is extremely high and debt is very high tells you that there is the conditions for a perfect storm. A perfect storm means that there could be a sharp correction of the prices of US bonds. And this can create plenty of losses in countries that have financed the US through this purchase of bonds. Now, if you have plenty of debt, how do you solve it? Look at the US after the Second World War. They had 120 points of debt. This is what it costed them to defeat the Nazis. And as you see today, they are at quite similar levels. Okay. Now, the US was able to reduce its level of debt up to levels of 20% before the Vietnam War. Do you think that this was achieved through saving? No, it was achieved through inflation. 80% of the reduction on this level of debt was through inflation. So be sure that the current level of debt of the US, 100%, a big portion of the decrease in the future will come through inflation. And obviously, this is bad news for those who are financing a country that might be running inflation to deflate away the level of debt. And this is the big risk I see in the current account surplus and the savings of the Gulf. Normally, you quote equities through price earnings, and you quote bonds through yields. The inverse of a yield is a price earning. Okay. What this tells you is that normally bonds and equities have been worth 15 times over history. Today you have equities at 13 times earnings, you have bonds at 60 times earnings. Never in history you have had such a disparity between bonds and equities. So concentrating the portfolios in bonds at the most expensive price of the history with plenty of risk of debt and inflation is extremely risky. And I think this should be well flagged in countries such as yours. The other risky point here is that the central banks are printing money massively. They have never printed as much money as today. You see the Federal Reserve, they used to have 6 points of GDP as money being printed. Today they are close to 20 points. And similar situations you can see in England, in Japan, or in Europe. So if you're lending money to countries that are printing money, this is extremely dangerous as well. Because this, sooner or later, will imply inflation. Don't doubt it. Finally, on this point, you can lend money to a country, that is able to finance its deficit with the domestic savings. In the case of Japan, they have plenty of debt, yes, but 100% of this debt is owned by the Japanese. So the riskiness of Japan is kind of low because basically they owe money to themselves. Look at the structure of the US Treasury holdings. 1945, 99% was owned by Americans. Today, 50% of bonds and bills are owned by Americans, 50% are owned by foreigners. And this makes this bond structure quite risky. This works as long as people keep having a faith in the Federal Reserve, they keep having a faith that this will be an economy with limited inflation. If this assumption do not happen, then there is a huge risk of a repricing of these assets. To the downside, of course. This is Deutsche Bank's estimates of what kind of inflation they would be expecting on the US in the following years. As you see, the average is 4%. Now, if you have a US 10-year bond yielding 1.9% and average inflation is 4%, this means you are losing your money. Having seen the first risk, which is that the kingdom has too much exposure into US dollar and bonds, and this is a serious risk, the second we must analyze is the diversification of the Saudi economy, which relies too much into oil. You have here the evolution of the GDP of the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia to levels close to $600 billion. The Spanish economy has a GDP of 1 trillion euros, so that you put it in context. So it has been growing nicely, but the problem, of course, is that it relies a lot on just one sector, which is oil. And obviously, the level of trade is 150% of GDP, which is not the case in other countries. Look at Canada or Russia are quite smaller. Actually, the kingdom has not improved its reliance on oil. You have the breakdown of the GDP in 1992, and at the end, 42% was related to oil, and today, 62%. Obviously, this makes sense as oil price has been going up. But again, the riskiness of this diversification of the economies is huge. And to finish off, I'd like to touch a little bit the ideas behind Islamic finance and how to put them together with the situation of the current account surplus of the kingdom. As you know, the situation with Islamic finance in general and Sukuk issuance has been a constant growth. And what you're seeing is that more and more companies are using Sukuk as a way to finance infrastructure. There is plenty of elements to believe that this is going to keep growing. Now, if Saudi Arabia has the liquidity and you have a banking system which 50% is already Islamic finance, there is plenty of elements to believe that this is a huge opportunity for the kingdom to create a powerful industry of Islamic finance and to benefit from this global trend. As you know, the key challenge to keep growing the Sukuk investor base is basically to develop institutional investors able to buy these instruments. And the big problem is that the development of insurance or Islamic insurance has been limited, especially in many countries. As long as Saudi Arabia is able to develop an Islamic insurance industry, then there will be institutions willing to buy the Sukuks. If you do this on a nice way, then Saudi Arabia could claim to be one of the pivotal roles or the pivotal countries for developing the Islamic finance industry. But again, it's key to develop the buying side of the bond side, which is basically insurance. As you see, today 70% of the issuance takes place in Malaysia, but in Malaysia they don't have the kind of oil or current account surplus you have. So you have the ingredients to be the leading country for Islamic finance. And it's interesting also to see that plenty of the Sukuk takes place by commercial banks. Okay? Today you have very powerful commercial banks which are Islamic in Saudi Arabia, but they cannot issue more Sukuks because they don't have people to sell them the Sukuks to, which is basically the insurance companies. If you look at what has happened with the banking world, what you see is that the assets of banks have been growing at a very nice rate up to the crisis. And after the crisis, assets have not been growing in the West, but still you have a huge growth in Islamic banking assets. So there is a clear tendency that this is a growth market, and that's why I think there is a good opportunity for the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. So we used to have $1.3 trillion in 2001, and there is today $1.8 trillion. Okay? And as you see here, the Gulf has represented a big portion of this growth. As more and more part of the system becomes Islamized, then you have a situation by which these industries keep growing well above others. As I said yesterday, there is more money today managed with Islamic finance than managed by hedge funds or managed by private equity houses. And what you see is that the penetration of the Islamic banking is quite high in the Gulf. And this, again, is an excellent opportunity to develop the industry going forward, okay, with systems that are, especially in Saudi Arabia, with 64% penetration. Another interesting point is that the industry is quite profitable. If you look at the net interest margin of the industry, you'll see that Islamic banks are more profitable than non-Islamic banks. Again, this has to do with plenty of factors. One of them is the attitude towards risk, which is much better than non-Islamic banks. But this is another fundamental reason why I believe that there is plenty of growth, because if you have an industry which makes sense and is profitable, then it should keep growing. What you see here is that at the end, the market is in Malaysia, but you have plenty of assets in Saudi Arabia. So the key challenge is how to make a market out of these assets. You have all the fundamentals to have the leading position in Islamic finance, but plenty of regulatory change needs to happen for this to be a reality. You have the largest commercial bank in Islamic finance, which is Al Raji. Okay, as you can see, the profitability is very high. And Saudi Arabia has several of the largest Islamic banks. Again, you have another on the ingredients to make this happen. Okay, and finally, here it's interesting to see that still there is plenty of need to issue sukuks to finance infrastructure. So if you have people who need to issue sukuks and you have the money to buy them through the commercial banks or through the insurance company, again, you have all the fundamentals for Saudi Arabia to be the leading capital in Islamic finance. Just to finish off, a few conclusions. I think that it is today the current account surplus of Saudi Arabia is extremely, extremely important to understand the balancing of global imbalances. It's key to understand the surplus you have to understand why the world keeps working as it is, and it is good. But this implies two major risks for your country. First, having too much exposure to dollars is extremely risky, and second, this surplus relies on just one main source of income, which is oil. And these are the two challenges your country must work upon to diversify away, to reduce the dependence on the dollar and to reduce the dependence on the oil. And perhaps one route to accelerate this transition and diversification would be to build at a very fast speed the industry of Islamic finance. Shukran.
Thank you very much, Dr. De La Torre. I think just in a two-word summary of the two presenters, obviously, Saudi Arabia has a major role in balancing out the world finance because of its role in the price and production on oil and gas. And also with the presentation of Dr. De La Torre, of course, having such a key role, it has some important challenges. What to do with the surplus, and as well, how to diversify the economy. I think the conclusion Dr. De La Torre wanted to say is like, buy Spanish bonds instead of American bonds. I think that will be the summary conclusion for the session today. We have about 15 minutes, a little less, for questioning. So please raise your hands and introduce yourself before having the question. Yes, please.
Bashir Kurdi, سفير متقاعد. في الحديث عن أسعار البترول وعن كمية البترول اللي عم تنتجها في المملكة العربية السعودية وسعي المملكة للاعتدال. أنا أجد أن أسعار البترول في المملكة ما زالت على ما هي عليه خلال 30 سنة الماضية أو أكثر. فقبل أن تنسحب الولايات المتحدة الأمريكية من تغطية عملتها بالذهب، كنا في المملكة السعودية حتى نحصل على ما قيمة أنصة الذهب لازم نبيع 10 براميل بترول. واليوم حتى نحصل على أنصة الذهب واحدة لازم نبيع 15 برميل. وبالتالي احنا الان عم نبيع بترولنا اقل مما كان عليه في السابق، وهذا بيساعد في عمليه اعتدال الاسعار. لو رجعنا للذهب وحاولنا نقيم سعرنا القديم على اساس الذهب اليوم، كان مفروض سعر البرميل يرتفع مرتين او ثلاثه. شكرا.
شكرا سعاده السفير. في الواقع الذهب ليس عمله وسيطة الآن في التداولات الدولية. صحيح كان إلى نهاية إلى عام 72 كان الذهب هو العملة الرئيسية وكان الدولار معتمد على الذهب. لكن الآن أنت المملكة وكثير من الدول العربية بتعتمد على واردات على احتياجاتها من الواردات، معنى آخر تستورد معظم احتياجاتها. فطالما إنه الدولار والعملات المختلفة الأخرى تفي لها باحتياجاتها ناهيك عن الذهب، إذن ما في تخوف، يعني ليست هناك مقارنة بين سعر البرميل وسعر الذهب. الذهب كلنا يعرف لماذا بيرتفع الآن، والمضاربة قائمة بشكل كبير سواء في الذهب أو حتى في البترول في الآونة الأخيرة. لكن أنا لا أجد هذه المقارنة عادلة. المقارنة لابد أن تكون معدلات التضخم العالمي تأثيرها على القيمة الحقيقية للعائدات البترولية، وأيضا يعني ما هي السلة بمعنى آخر، ما هي السلة من الواردات التي تستطيع أن تشتري بها مقابل كل برميل من البترول بالنسبة لواردات المملكة مقارنة في هذا العام مقارنة بالأعوام السابقة. فإذا أخذت هذه أنا أعتقد عادلة، لأنه سعر البرميل ارتفع من 20-30 دولار في السبعينات في الثمانينات إلى أن وصل إلى 147 في عام 2008 إلى أن وصل الآن في حدود 100-110 دولار للبرميل. أنا أعتقد أنه هذه عادلة بشكل كبير. أيضا قيمة الدولار تأثرت صحيح أمام العملات الأخرى، لكن التأثرات هذه متقلبة. يعني نجد في فترات الدولار منخفض جدا أمام اليورو والعملات الأخرى، في فترات أخرى تحسن. الفترة الحالية الآن تحسن الدولار أمام سلة العملات المختلفة، وهذا يعطي ميزة إضافية كون المملكة بتحصل على كل إيراداتها البترولية بالدولار. صحيح هنالك تنويع فيما بعد في العملات وحصيلة العملات التي تمتلكها المملكة، لكن حتما الحصيلة الأكبر في الدولار. والمملكة الآن يعني لا تود أن تغير من ارتباطها بالدولار من جهة، وأيضا لا تود أن ترفع سعر عملتها مقابل الدولار من جهة أخرى. الأسعار البترول لا زالت مريحة بالنسبة، ولو أنه المملكة نحن تعودنا الآن على سعر 100 دولار، وكلنا سمعنا تصريح المهندس النعيمي قبل يومين بأنه 100 دولار هو سعر مناسب للمملكة والدول المنتجة. في تصوري أنه الخوف هو لو نزلت الأسعار عن 100 دولار قد نتأثر بالنسبة للإنفاق المحلي، طالما نحن تعودنا على مستوى 80-90 دولار لتوازن الميزانية المحلية.
عم نتعامل بالدولار وموضوع الثقة بالدولار الأمريكي ثقة مهزوزة إلى حد ما، لأن الدولار اللي أنا أمسكه بيدي الورقي لا يساوي أكثر من قيمة الورق والحبر عليه، بينما تعاملي مع عملات تانية قد يكون يعني.
حتى
فهل حنرجع إحنا لسلة عملات بدل ما نعتمد على دولار؟
حتى العملات الثانية معرضة للاهتزاز، وهذا نتذكر النقاش هذا نفسه دار قبل 3 أعوام حينما كان الدولار في أقل مستوياته، وكانت الطلبات مختلفة حتى في الداخل في مقالات في الصحف بالابتعاد عن الدولار وتبني سلة العملات. لكن لما حينما تغيرت قيم العملات الأخرى وجدنا أنه يعني أنت هنا ما هتعطي predictability للمستثمرين ولا المتعاملين مع الأسواق السعودية، لأنه ما تعرف إيش اللي حيصير بالنسبة لسعر العملة سواء الريال أو العملات الأخرى اللي حتكون مرتبطة بالريال. فأنا أتصور أنه السياسة الحالية بالنسبة لربط الريال بالدولار هي سياسة في الوقت الحالي، والظروف الحالية هي أنسب سياسة بالنسبة للمملكة
إن شاء الله.
ونستطيع أن نتكلم في هذا المجال فيما بعد بيني وبينك
إن شاء الله.
إن شاء الله. شكرا.
أوكي بليز. You wanted to ask a question, just scream. Oh. I'll repeat it to you.
Okay. Hello.
Ladies first.
Ah, okay, ladies first.
Sorry. Good afternoon, everybody. I would like to thank the audience and also the speakers, Dr. Mohamed Al-Sabban, Dr. Ignacio de la Torre. I would choose to speak in English and I hope it's not a problem. My questions is for Dr. De la Torre. You have spoke in the beginning about the risks that the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia is taking globally. And then you have spoken about the Islamic banking and how profitable it is. Are you saying that this could be, all in all, a diversified plan for the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia? My other part of the question, have we considered the Dutch disease and investing in the capital market and the resources?
Could you repeat? We haven't understood. Which disease?
The Dutch disease. It's the economical term for Denmark when they have not focused on exporting, but only importing. When in the past they had all the accumulated or the sources of crude oil, and they have lost it gradually or maybe slowly, but through time. So, all in all, is the plan of the Islamic banking really balancing the risks that Saudi Arabia is making globally?
Okay, thank you for the questions. On the first one, my point is that on one hand, I make a distinction between selling in dollars the oil, which is one thing, and another thing is what do you do with your asset allocation of your reserves. When I speak on the risk of the dollar, I speak on the second. Okay? And I believe that the reserves of the kingdom are too much biased towards the US dollar and in bonds, and this is a risk. The second risk was associated with having an industry which represents 70% of your income. What I was saying is that I see the fundamentals that one way to diminish the weight of oil into the economy is to develop the Islamic finance industry within Saudi Arabia. If you look at the financial industry, it tends to represent in any country 15-20 points of GDP. Okay? And you have all the fundamentals to make this industry to grow very rapidly in Saudi Arabia, and this would be an indirect way of reducing the weight of oil. On the other hand, the fact that through sukuks you can finance plenty of long-term investments, such as infrastructure, this would be another way to rely on infrastructure to reduce the weight of the risk associated with oil, which would be something similar to what the Chinese have done in the last 4 years.
Just very little point with regard to just putting it in Islamic banking or sukuk, as you said. That's fine, no objection to it. The problem is that you need to be more diversified. You cannot rely just only on the sukuk to do that. And the only way to do it is basically to follow the other good practices around the world, including the sovereign funds, where you can diversify. You buy assets in the companies, you buy Islamic sukuk, you buy whatever that will keep will minimize your risk. Otherwise, if you say that the solution is Islamic sukuk, I am Muslim and I am for it. It is not the solution.
Of course. I think that at the end, if you, the reserves of the kingdom are managed conventionally, not through Islamic finance, and I think sukuk should be one more asset class. But I'm not talking about on the official money, but on the private money, the money which is in the Islamic banking industry or in private in Islamic insurance. And the second question, as you know, there is something called the oil curse, which is related to your question, which is exactly the same problem that we had in Spain because we discovered America, and then we had plenty of gold coming over, and we were not lucky to use these inflows on a productive basis. So when the flood of gold stopped, then Spain had a big problem. And I think that Saudi has the opportunity today, many years ahead, to avoid this mistake by diversifying away. Otherwise, if the price of oil is very high and you match your budget at $90 and there is not enough speed in rebalancing the economy, then the risks that the kingdom will be incurring will be very high going forward.
Okay. Last question, because since each question is taking a whole debate, I think we'll have time for one more question and then we will continue the debate outside. I'm sure many of you will be interested. Please.
Just turn on the mic.
سؤالي لسعادة الدكتور محمد الصبان، ما هي توقعاتكم لمستقبل أسعار النفط لنقل بعد 5 سنوات من الآن، خاصة بعد سعي الولايات المتحدة الحثيث لإنتاج الزيت الصخري وأيضا الأبحاث العالمية في إيجاد طاقات بديلة؟
شكرا سعادة الدكتور. بالنسبة للتوقعات القادمة، في كثير من المتغيرات حدثت في الأسواق. هنالك تغيرات هيكلية بتحدث في أسواق الطاقة غير مسبوقة، ولن تعود إلى ما كانت لو انخفض أسعار البترول. من هذه التغيرات كما ذكرت هو زيادة الاحتياطيات الكبيرة من النفط والغاز الصخري. الآن الولايات المتحدة تتحدث، بغض النظر مين حيكون رقم واحد في الإنتاج، أمريكا، المملكة، هذه ما يعنينا الأمر، لكن التخوف هو لو فعلا وصلت الولايات المتحدة للاكتفاء الذاتي، بمعنى أنها لا تستورد أي برميل. الآن واردات أمريكا تساوي واردات الصين 6 مليون، قصدي واردات أمريكا نعم 6 مليون برميل، والصين 6.1 مليون. أملنا الآن في خلال السنتين الماضية الطلب العالمي على البترول في منظمة التعاون الاقتصادي والتنمية الـ OECD انخفض بما لا يقل عن 3%، انخفاض كبير، أكثر من 2 مليون برميل يوميا خلال هذه الفترة. لولا الزيادة التي طرأت النتيجة لاستمرار معدلات النمو المرتفعة في الصين والهند والإمرجينج إيكونوميز، لكان لوضح التأثير السلبي للانخفاض الكبير الذي حدث في اقتصاديات الدول الغربية، في نمو الطلب على البترول في الدول الغربية. طبعا جزء من الانخفاض هذا هو بسبب الأزمة الاقتصادية العالمية، لكن كما ذكر دانيال ييرغن اللي مؤلف كتاب البرايز ذا برايز، ذكر قال انه ترى الأزمة العالمية أخفت تغير حقيقي وجوهري في الطلب العالمي على البترول في الدول الصناعية، وهذه حقيقة كلنا نعرفها. الآن أملنا كله في الدول الإمرجينج إيكونومي، الصين، الهند، البرازيل، ساوث أفريكا إلى آخر، لكن هذه الدول لا تكرر أخطاء السابقين، بمعنى آخر they are going to be more efficient, they are going to use more renewable energies etc. لأنه يهمهم أنهم يخفضوا فاتورة الواردات أيضا. فبالتالي الاعتماد أو ترك الأمل بأنه الدول الإمرجينج إيكونوميز حيستمروا في النمو وبمعدلات كبيرة غير صحيح. تصوري أنا أنه 5 سنوات قد نكون أوكي بالنسبة للأسعار، قد تستمر في حدود 70-80 دولار إذا انتهت أزمة إيران. طالما أزمة إيران باقية، المضاربة لا زالت تحتدم ولا زالت التخوفات أنه قد تنفجر في أي يوم من الأيام، وبالتالي هنالك مزيد من التحوط من قبل المضاربين، ما يسمى بالهيدجينج، فيما لو تعرضت المنطقة لأي حادث لا سمح الله، وبالتالي الأسعار قد ترتفع إلى مستويات غير مسبوقة. لكن في الظروف العادية أنا في تصوري أنه لو انتهت الأزمة الإيرانية وانتهت المشكلة السورية somehow، الأسعار قد تنخفض من 70-80 دولار، هذا تصور شخصي، والتصور هذا مبني على الفائض اللي موجود الآن في الأسواق. طبعا وقتها إيش اللي بيصير؟ اللي بيصير أيضا المملكة حتكون swing producer، بمعنى آخر المملكة والدول الأخرى تحاول أن تخفض من إنتاجها عشان تحافظ على الأسعار، لكن تخفيضنا من إنتاجنا عشان نحافظ على أسعار في حدود 80-90 دولار مثلا حيؤثر على الحصيلة الكاملة للإيرادات النفطية في المملكة، وبالتالي يؤثر على الحجم الذي نحتاجه لتوازن الميزانية. كل هذه الأمور لابد أن نضعها في بالنا، أن العالم قادم على ثورة في مجال الطاقة كبيرة جدا غير مسبوقة، وعلينا أن ننوع اقتصادنا. الكلام اللي تكلم عنه تنويع الاقتصاد نحن نتكلم عنه من سنين، ولكن ليس هنالك تنويع حقيقي. نحتاج أن نركز على التعليم، ذكرنا في الصباح مسألة المجتمع المعرفي، تطوير التعليم هو الأساس. إذا أوجدنا السعودي المبتكر المبدع نستطيع أن ندخل مختلف المجالات ونقلل من اعتمادنا على الإيرادات الكبيرة من البترول. شكراً.
شكراً كثيراً وشكراً لكلكم. أظن أن I think we is not time left. So شكراً كثيراً لكلكم وفرصة سعيدة. Thank you very much.
شكراً لأصحاب السعادة المتحدثين. ويتفضل معالي مدير جامعة الملك عبد العزيز الأستاذ الدكتور أسامة بن صادق طيب بتقديم دروع الشكر والتقدير لأصحاب السعادة المشاركين في هذه الندوة. درع لسعادة الدكتور محمد سالم الصبان مستشار وزير البترول والثروة المعدنية. ودرع لسعادة الدكتور إغناثيو دي لاتوري من جامعة الآي إي. ودرع لمديرة الجلسة الدكتورة سيليا دي أنكو. Your Highness, Your Excellencies, Ladies and Gentlemen, that concludes the activities of the third symposium of Saudi moderation conducted by Prince Khalid Al-Faisal Chair, and we would like to invite you all for dinner, for lunch.